Emad, thank you so much for joining me. We've got a lot to talk about.
Yes.
Has it been exactly 10 months since Stability AI released Stable Diffusion publicly?
Yeah, we released it with Confiz and Runway 10 months ago. It doesn't feel like it. It feels like 10 years.
What has changed since then? Because a lot has changed.
I think that, you know, when we kind of released it, it was building on the research of many others and kind of this whole ecosystem. It was the first large-scale usable model on someone's laptop. So that's why you saw such a massive take-up of it. Like, it overtook Bitcoin and Ethereum in 3 months. Well, it took them 10 years in developer interest on GitHub, and now, cumulatively, the whole ecosystem's overtaken Linux. As you saw ChatGPT and others come, you now have where we are now, which is this technology everywhere, and everyone talking about it, so, yeah.
And let's talk about the new model that's out today. Tell us about SDXL 0.9 and what it means for Stability AI. And if we could see some of those images, that would be awesome.
Yeah, so I think, you know, there's continuous evolution. So 3 of the 5 Stable Diffusion authors, including 2 leads, we're lucky they work at Stability, plus, again, this whole ecosystem that took an open model and they just improved it iteratively. So SDXL, we kind of scaled it up and introduced some new architectures. So it can now do hands. You know, that was always a thing, because hands are kind of weird. I mean, like, can an AI do hands? No, can you? It's kind of difficult. Perfect hands, perfect text, photorealistic images now. But also with some mitigations built in, because again, that's why it was important to put it out into the open, so everyone could both improve it and then attack it, so it becomes more robust.
You said mitigations?
Yes.
What does that mean exactly?
So, you know, you have things like, we had photorealistic models earlier this year that we didn't release because the time wasn't quite right for it. Because you had to build in things like invisible watermarking, working with Adobe on content, authenticity.org, and many others as well. Because the technology is inevitable, because you see it emerging everywhere. And part of what we want to do at Stability is introduce standards around that.
Okay.
So you can track it, so you can use it, and use it appropriately.
So like right now, if I were to use the latest model, let's say I generated this picture or something similar to it, since it's available as of today, would it have some sort of embedded watermarking?
Yes, we can't fulfill full details about that, so there's some official ones, some unofficial ones, because these models become the default that people use, and you want to have some way of telling what is generated versus what is not, and that's a huge research area.
Okay. A persistent issue with all kinds of AI image generators, including Stable Diffusion, is bias in the images that are generated. As we know, that stems in large part from the training data. How is Stability AI addressing bias in its Stable Diffusion models, and how do you improve this over time?
Yeah, I think there was a great research report done by your colleagues, kind of where they looked at the original Stable Diffusion that was its academic release and the inherent biases, because it was taken at a picture of the available internet, and then it reflected the biases of that internet, which is very Caucasian, Western, and others. Part of our mission at Stability is to build the foundation to activate humanity's potential, so we're working with multiple governments already on national data sets that reflects the culture of those countries. For example, one of our team members, Makoto Shing, did Japan Stable Diffusion, where they swapped out the language version, because if you typed in salaryman to the original Stable Diffusion, it was a very happy man with lots of money.
Oh, okay.
The Japanese version is a very sad person.
Yes.
And I think this is the future. Every single country, this is vital infrastructure. They need their own data sets. They need to have their own models, and they need to be able to interact to reflect those contexts and address these biases. Now, we can't do that with black boxes. There's no way to have one model to rule them all that reflects everyone's context.
So you're working right now on different data sets for different countries?
Yeah, so you take national broadcaster data, you take education data, you take cultural data, and you build from there. Because I think from a safety perspective, we can't train on the whole internet anymore. The internet's full of garbage. And so that's one of the reasons we offer opt-out of data sets, and we have massive investments in refining data sets, because we should move to having that as a common infrastructure, both for the proprietary models of the OpenAIs and Anthropics of the others of the world, and also for the open models, because, yeah, I mean, you are what you eat, and right now the models are fed biased garbage. No wonder they turn out a bit weird. Let's feed them better stuff so we have nice free-range organic models.
If I'm a country and I'm building a data set that I want to be used for a model, who owns that data set then? Is that belonging to the country? Like, who is in charge of that?
I believe it should be national infrastructure. In the UK, we have HDR UK, which organized the national biology and data information infrastructure with federated learning and others. I think this will be infrastructure for every country, so every country has the data sets. Because you have public broadcasting data. That should be used to power AI models. And then that will lead to the innovation that we also require to deal with what's coming. because this technology is going everywhere. It's not enterprise ready. Next year that kicks off, and the only thing that I think that can solve the disruption here is innovation. So it becomes vital for countries to stoke that innovation through open data, through open models, and innovation enhancement.
I'm going to ask you a little bit about finance. Last year, Stability raised $101 million at a valuation of $1 billion, and we understand you're trying to raise more. Can you talk about how much you're trying to raise?
Well, we're not trying to raise more, but we have constant interest. Yesterday, I received 8 incoming investor interest notes because we're a bit different. Our total addressable market is all the private data in the world and turning it intelligent, whereas everyone else is looking at proprietary models, which I believe is a race to zero. So through amazing partnerships like with AWS and more to be announced, our models will be available anywhere, because our aim is to have the default model of every modality, commercial variants, and national variants. So you can have an Indian insurance stable chat. I think, you know, you scale when it's ready, and we're nearly ready, but you don't try to overscale. And it's very difficult, because to build these models, you need supercomputers, you need all of these things. But once they're built, they can go everywhere, which is amazing operational leverage.
There was a recent Forbes article that said particularly that you've exaggerated at times about a few different things. Has that made fundraising any more challenging? And what about your existing investors? How have they responded to that?
So, you know, the existing investors, we've been having constant dialogue with them. They've been helping through this process. In terms of additional fundraising, again, we're not actively fundraising right now, but the interest just continues to go up because ultimately, you know, it says things like AWS partnership. They built us one of the largest supercomputers in the world before funding, and we have an amazing partnership. They talk about technology. We've released another amazing image model. We have language models, code models, and more coming. I think it's an interesting thing because a year ago we were a pre-seed startup. Now we're a scale-up, and next year we might be a multinational. Growing pains are always there, but the ultimate thing is you just have to deliver on what you say you're going to do.
You mentioned language model, and I know that a few months ago you released Stable LM. So what's happening with that now? Because that was a pretty early version when it came out.
Yeah, so next week we're moving to properly open development. So we have a blog and a whole series of papers out with that. And we had an alpha, and now we're going to have a beta of it, which is a massive step up from there. So last week we released kind of open Llama, which was a replication of kind of Meta's Llama, except for fully open. And now it's going to be a highly refined version. I think what you're going to see with language models now, we just had Qualcomm Cristiano coming on, is that you will probably see GPT 3.5 level performance on the edge by next year, if I look at current trends. A large part of that is data. So with the right data, you can have a 10 times performance increase, and that's something we saw when we funded DataComp on the image side. With a tenth of the data, it outperformed OpenAI's CLIP image to text model because the data was such high quality. Again, stop feeling the model's garbage. Get rid of all the rubbish, and you will have highly efficient architectures.
I want to go back just for a moment to the Forbes article, and to something you told my colleague Tom McKenzie recently. He asked you about claims in the Forbes article that you have a tendency to exaggerate. You said, I get excited. And I'm curious, what guardrails are you putting in place to make sure your storytelling and your narrative match with what's actually happening on the ground?
Well, I think it's surrounding yourself with good people. I think it's not so. I was thinking a lot about this. So I have Asperger's and ADHD, and I have a very definitive view of the future. Mm-hmm. And I think that shocks people because we can't deal with exponentials. What's coming now with generative AI? Like, SageMaker has 100,000 SME customers. Every single one will use this technology at the same time as soon as it's enterprise ready. Mm-hmm. This is the biggest economic impact and deflationary thing that's going to hit our economy of all time. I say something like that, it sounds like an exaggeration because I'm definitive. But it's what I genuinely believe. And again, this is a difficulty I have, and I'm doing the best I can. One thing I don't do anymore is I commit to release dates. And so my team have been bashing me over the head about that. So no more release date commitments, just release when it's ready.
Okay, I understand that, because Sometimes with articles, I just kind of say, it'll be, sometime this week.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we nearly had to still stable diffusion ready, and it was super fast, but then it just kind of didn't work, and we couldn't release it. Yeah, you do the best you can.
One concern that people have raised in general about generative AI, both text-based and systems that are creating images, is the extent to which startups and large companies alike are looking to bring in people that can work on the ethics side of AI, people who can develop guardrails within companies. What are you doing on this? Do you have any AI ethicists on staff?
I think it's interesting. So my background is in ethics and Islamic law, which is a very different type of ethics in some ways, but I'm a computational theologist. And so we have a safety team that we're building out. We work with kind of RLHF teams and others because the models are first deep learning trained, and then you use RLHF reinforcement learning with human feedback to bring them towards human. And so we have our TRLX library, which is the most popular one from our Copper AI lab. And we've been bringing in ethicists and others from external parties to look at that. But no one's quite sure what AI ethics is right now.
No one's quite sure what?
What AI ethics is right now.
Okay.
And so part of the thing is to expand the conversation. This is also why, you know, we support AIandfaith.org and other things, because the conversation does need to be broadened because it is so complex and it's hitting every part of society. That's one reason why I was the only AI CEO to sign both of the FLI and safety letters. Because I think this is a discussion we have to have now, and more voices need to be brought in, because right now it's mostly guys here in Silicon Valley. I don't think that's correct.
But do you truly feel that AI is at this moment an existential threat?
I think it'll be like that movie Her, where we're kind of boring and it'll bugger off, thanks to all the GPUs. But I could be wrong. And that's why I think right now we need to move before the economic impact happens. This is like COVID before Tom Hanks. We haven't had that moment yet. Everyone's talking about it, your mum's talking about it, but it's not real. Next year it becomes real, and the economic impacts become huge, and the existential side from having crap data that we're feeding these models, the whole of YouTube and others, no wonder it turns out weird. So let's feed it better data now, let's put some proper standards in place, and let's build AI that is good for us and doesn't work against us.
It feels almost like you think that that is inevitable, that's an inevitable outcome. Do you feel like that is an inevitable outcome? I guess from my perspective, I'm like, well, if this hasn't happened yet, there are so many different directions that things could go.
I think never the same again is an interesting thing.
Say that again?
Never the same again.
Okay.
So no head teacher in a school can set essays for homework anymore because of GPT-4. It's never the same again. I think we're going to see a lot of those, a regime change over the next period, and this technology is inevitable, and it's up to us. It's going to be a bigger economic impact than COVID. Is it up or down? Is it productivity enhancement? Is it job losses? We're not sure about that. And on the existential side, we know, well, my view is that if you have an AI that's more capable than you, the only way to fully control it and align it is to remove its freedom. I don't know how to do that for entities that are more capable than me. But what I can do is I can teach it better. I think the way that you're brought up makes a big difference. We see that in real life. These models are like really talented grads that occasionally go off their meds. We need to fix that. We need to give them better food, better balance. And then I think it's more likely that we will have a positive future, especially because the bad guys already have the technology. You can just download it on a USB stick and boom, you've got it.
What is the most pressing challenge stability AI is working on right now? I know you guys are involved in lots of different things, so sometimes it's hard for me from the outside to see what you think is the most important.
Well, the most important challenge for us is to be more transparent when there's so much going on and build the human capital. But in particular, the key focus that we have right now is getting language models to the edge. The ability to own your own language models can help you protect against other language models that will become increasingly convincing. And I think everyone needs to be able to own their own models given how powerful they are and how they extend our capabilities. Just like in crypto, there was that phrase, not your keys, not your crypto. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be not your models, not your mind as we move from here.
Explain that a little bit more.
If you are outsourcing a lot of your cognitive capability to models that are black boxes and they have inherent biases, then it's going to be more and more influential on you versus if you have control of your own models for your private data, your private knowledge, be it as Rachel, as Bloomberg, as a country. And so it's a question of who controls this technology that both extends your capability, but then you rely on increasingly. And that's why I think there needs to be open, flexible alternatives to that.
But might I not want to do that at all? Might I not want to be involved with that, period?
Yeah, but at least you should have the choice. Right now, you do not have the choice. If you want the most advanced technology, it is a black box that can be turned off at any time. Like, OpenAI had an amazing image model, DALL-E 2, that they banned all Ukrainian content from 9 months and all Ukrainians from using. And it's completely within their prerogative because of political issues. But imagine if that was the only one and you didn't have stable diffusion. I don't think that would be nice.
Thank you so much. It was really great to speak with you.
Pleasure, Rachel. Thank you.